Okay, Tanya, thank you very much for introducing us. A very warm welcome. Well, all right, before I'd like to start into all these art of term sheets, I'm curious, who of you or how many of you are founders? Just, wow. Have you already done a financing round? Just the minority. Okay, good. Are you familiar with that format tonight? Most of you are, but anyway, basically the format is pretty simple. We've organized the content into a certain number of key issues, and any term sheet could have 100 of issues. So just take care. What we're doing, we're not going to any all of the clauses, because that might be for much details. We've got 2 hours, something around this, and that would lead, well, we can't do 100 issues within a two-hour session. When we are talking about term sheets for tonight, this term sheet you received is typically is one of the what you would typically would receive from a VC like Olaf. So, and he's smart. So that's a very smart term sheet, and I believe Jens had a lot to discuss with him. Anyway, when you talk about term sheets, it always gets to a lot of conversation. There are tons of comments out there, sort of what are market terms, what is standard in every VC term, this is a standardized one, and what are the pitfalls, and in particular, what are the traps on the way to get your startup funded. Technically, a term sheet is nothing more than a document which outlines the key financial and other terms of a proposed investment and provides a roadmap for everybody to the financial deal structure or to the final deal structure by the end. Term sheets are critical and more just than a letter of intent. Please take or bear that in mind. Term sheets can get very difficult and they can be really hard to understand. And you may need help determining which various provisions, such like liquidation preferences, anti-dilution clauses, drag-along rights, vesting, and so on, imply for your future rights and obligations when you're a founder of a company. But nothing to be afraid of. If you gain a kind of understanding about what a term sheet is and what the conceptual ideas are behind the single clause, then you might be on the safe side to discuss with Olaf. If you think about what from a founder's position who is looking to raise money from an outside investor, there have to bear in mind a lot of different things, and you try to put yourself into the boots of the VC to argue with them. What is a VC looking about with a term sheet? What is their intention to? First of all, they want to raise. When you raise money, they are looking for that they can realize. Sorry, guys. Damn. VC is looking to keep control over their company. The founders are looking to keep control over their company and not to be diluted by the investment. That's the one-hand side. And they basically want to stay employed. I mean the founders. We're talking about the founders in that very moment. While they're doing with their company. They don't want to be actually kicked out by the end of the day. So those are the positions they really take and go with, and they have when they're looking to raise money. Sorry for that. The interesting thing is, when you take the position and consider the goals of an investor, in many cases, they seem to be exactly the opposite. The investors want to get most of their ownership for a certain amount of money. They want to get the most of control. They want to get the most of an amount of proceeds when they wanted to protect, and they want to protect their downside. So you can see right now it can be challenging to raise money because the position that both sides are taking are divergent. There are probably two different ways you can look at a term sheet. First of all, either you look at a term sheet as the investment, how to get in, or how to raise money, stuff like this, or you just quickly frame them, look at term three buckets. So there are a lot of term sheet could be divided into three buckets. First of all, economic issues, which are such like valuation, liquidation preference, anti-dilution, vesting, employees pool and representation and warranties. That's one part of the most important thing of a term sheet. And the others are selected control issues. So what I said, if VC wants to take some control over their company to, well, to secure their investment or to control their investment. These are kind of protective provisions, drag along right, which we will discuss later, right of first refusal, kind of information rights. So this is how you could divide or see a term sheet. Then you have got some general terms, like we will discuss why do you need confidentiality, penalty clauses, expensive, etc. Anyway, before we do too long here, I think these guys started into, and I've handed over to the stage.
Boing, boing.
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 So, hello, everybody. Let's get started.
That's a typical term sheet from Olaf. Thanks, Olaf, for taking the time today. I brought my lawyer because we only have 2 hours. And as you have seen, and I told you before, there's a lot of interest in our business. So I don't want to waste any time with a VC that isn't moving too much on the things that we're really looking for. Just to be clear. The business we do, I think, is we have this big interest in our round. And I thank you for the term sheet. But I think it's clear that there are a lot of things that we cannot agree on. I know this is what you normally invest on, but this is just, quite frankly, not acceptable for us.
I'm on, but he's not, I suppose.
Try again.
No, hello. Further down. Hello.
Yeah.
Okay. First of all, I have to disagree with our junior associate Philip that this is a very standard term sheet. I think this is a maximum position that you have taken, that you could possibly take in most of the points. So I would suggest that we go through the points one by one and hopefully park certain points we cannot agree on and move through the term sheet pretty quickly.
Yeah.
Then focus at the end on certain points that we cannot immediately agree upon.
Yeah. You know, thanks for the meeting and for the 2 hours time. We have done a very intense market evaluation, and let's say the first diligence part with your team and with your company. We are somehow intrigued about the business and about the founding team. And I think you guys are interested to work with us as well. Otherwise, we wouldn't discuss a term sheet. So let's get started and take it step by step through the term sheet. So maybe you have the first point you want to discuss.
Yeah, I have the first point. First of all, you offered a 1 million euro investment round for a 20% post ownership. I have to say this is actually at the bottom end of what we received from other investors. Based on your market reputation, and I spoke to a lot of other founders you invested in, this is probably a position we can agree on if we kind of agree on the other terms. But basically the first roadblock we are having is the 25% milestone.
We parked this, this
just,
subject.
Just to comment on that.
Yeah, I mean, it really depends, you know.
Because
I
think Dark's Adventures went into cheap. And that's actually, we're not getting a lot of upside. You're actually paying market price looking at the other investors.
They went into cheap. So You negotiated a bad deal, right?
They brought a lot of experience into the business.
Okay, got it. They
helped us with hiring. And that's why we agreed on.
Okay.
And basically, they invested on a PowerPoint, which was kind of a leap of faith. They did. I mean, you can see the product. You know how it's working. So I think that's a reasonable amount, but it's still not. We're not square.
Yeah. So it is our opinion that we actually want the investment amount independent of any milestones or key performance indicators in one tranche, and do not want to divide it up and leave alone leaving the second tranche in your entire sole discretion. So that's that is not acceptable. We have to have planning security, and we have to know how much money we will get at the end of the day so that we can plan our budget accordingly.
Mm. So what we have offered here is $1 million investment, which is now according to your business plan for your run rate of the next 18 months, I think it's the money you need in order to keep your cash flow above water. That's why the $1 million. But as you know, you haven't sold a single product, so there is not even the first customer, and that's why we need to understand a little bit the traction of your of you know in the market, how many customers you can sign up. And well, normally we invest much bigger tickets because we are not the spray and pray investor you might know from the Berlin scene. If we invest, we put a lot of resources onto your company in order to help you to get out of the blocks, get customers, and find one of the AAA next follow-on investor. So that's why we were discussing intensively internally if we should do this deal, because $1 million is way too low for us. But we do understand that you won't get diluted that much, and that's why we put this term sheet on the table just with $1 million investment. We are happy to invest more, but in order to do so, we need some kind of downside protection in the case that the product doesn't work. So, as I said, it's a pre-product investment round, an A round, pre-revenue. And so I'm happy to discuss this clause with the tranches, and we can change it, but then, we have to find a way how to change it.
I just want to understand the 25%, because as you said before, we not quite know where the product, how it's going to be sold. If we have to, if we run out of cash with the 750K, we would have to adjust strategy based on not having enough liquidity, which I reckon would not be the best for the business to make decision based on the last quarter million euros, and said we should get the million, because it can be the case that we're seeing, oh, we actually need that 2 months, 3-4 months longer, and not start selling the product because the product is just not good enough yet. So I think this has to be discussed because, in my opinion, there will be a misalignment in
the business plan.
In the misalignment in from a shareholder perspective, that we actually think we have to readjust the product. We need 4 months longer for go-to-market. That actually requires us to get the quarter million euros. And in that case, you don't have to give it to us, or you're in a position where you can squeeze any more shares out of us on some kind of, I don't know, investors. I always put them more on the dark side of the spectrum.
Yeah. Well, I think at the end of the day, the company is planning and expecting a $1 million commitment. And if you say that $1 million is more on the lower end, I think we could rather consider increasing the $1 million, so make the $1 million as a minimum that we get right away, and allow you a subsequent subscription right in a next capital increase upon the achievement of certain milestones. But we actually want to leave it at the $1 million. In order to achieve what we've planned going forward.
Then let me do a suggestion here. We take the $1 million in one tranche, and an additional upside can we equalize to a downside protection. We invest the $1 million and we get an option for the next 9 months after closing to put another 500K at the same valuation to the company. So that would mean you have a longer run rate. If we have the impression that the product is working, but even it's starting slower, we can give you more cash. So it's not a downside protection for us, but it's a little bit more upside. I think this could work, right?
It has a further dilutive effect on the founders.
I think 9 months is too long if we agree on something like 6 with that. In the real world would never.
And also, we need to define the milestones that you need to.
No milestones. It's our our discretion. So our decision to put in up to 500K, and six months is okay because we already discussed the milestones for 6 months.
To be discussed. Next topic.
Okay. Just to interrupt you, let's take a quick break. So you agreed on that you will invest full amount of 1 million euros on a pre-money valuation of 4 million, or is it post-money valuation you're expecting?
No, it's 4 million. So it's pre-money, it's 20%.
So it's 5 million post.
Fully diluted.
Okay, we come to that.
We'll get to there in a minute.
Right. So for all of us, do you know the concepts or the difference between pre- and post-money valuation? You need to understand it. It's quite a simple concept. Pre-money valuation means the valuation of the company, which is the price of the company before the money of the investor gets into the company or flows into the company. And post-money valuation is just the pre-money valuation plus the investment sum. This is important to understand because sometimes a situation happens that VCs nor entrepreneurs really ever talked about whether they're talking about post or pre-money valuation. And if you talk about 4 million pre-money valuation and you invest a million, by the end of the day you earn 20% shares. If you talk about 4 million post-money valuation, that will be a 3 million pre-money valuation, you will own 25% of the company, which is a huge difference. So that's just to give you an idea who probably haven't that experience so far. But maybe a question to you, Jens and Olaf. How often do you see in the real world these kind of tranched models and milestones?
So I see it very often because I really like it. Hold on. So tranches, not as a downside protection for the investor. I have to say, in the introduction, it wasn't been mentioned. I was sitting on this side in 6 venture rounds. So 3 of my own startups, which I have grown or founded, we went through 6 venture rounds. So I know how an entrepreneur is feeling and what the fears of an entrepreneur could be. If he talks with the venture capitalist. Having said this, why do I like tranches, especially in early stage situations? Because it is a dilution protection for the founder and a downside protection for the investor. So it's a real, let's say, not win-win situation, but it's a good situation for everybody if the tranches have different valuations. So that means what I've done in the past, we have offered this, let's say, 50% of the first round of the seed round or A round on a, let's say, 4 million pre-money, and based on certain milestones, after 1 year or no, 1 year is too long, after half year or 9 months, another or the other 50% of the A round or seed round on a higher valuation. That means for us, if the milestones haven't been met, we can rediscuss and talk to the founders, in a nice way, because it's a cooperative relationship. To say, well, guys, you have oversold in your pitch. You didn't meet the milestones, and so on and so forth. For the founders, it means they have much longer run rate because they can work with, let's say, 1 million, not only 500K, and they don't have to go on fundraise after 6 months or after 3 months. Fundraising is the biggest distraction for founders. And if you can avoid fundraising, especially in the early phase of your company where you're alone or only with 2 founders, you should try to do this, not for every price, but if you can do it, if you can get more at the beginning on a, let's say, better valuation, and that's why 2 tranches, I think it's a good way.
I disagree.
It depends, you know, and I think to your point, Olaf, the earlier stage the investment you're talking about, the more often you see milestones. But the question is always, how do you define whether or not a milestone has been met? You know, not often you can say you have to sign up X amount of customers, or you have to make this much revenue, or, you know, often it's a mixture between amount of customers, revenue, run rate, and profit margin per customer, gross margin. So it's more the details that that often matter and are very, very difficult to define. And it's also something where you want to have not a one-side discretionary right, so the investor can say, well, I like the business, or I have second thoughts and I'd rather invest my money elsewhere. You want to have the investor make a full commitment so that you, when you meet those KPIs, can go to the investor and say, here it is, and now you must invest, and it's not at at your own discretion. Yeah. So, the advantage, I think, also from a founder standpoint, is that you have a bank already, that if you behave and you do well, then you can go to the bank and withdraw the money. But and it's kind of the carrot stick that's here ahead of you, and you are inclined to work towards achieving that in order to go back to the investor.
Yeah,
the downside for both,
I don't see it as a carrot.
Well, the downside for both, however, is what if it's not achieved?
Just to add to that, it's from a founder perspective, the biggest issue is that there's always a strategy shift happening, and it's pretty hard to commit to a timeline, especially when you're at that stage as liquid lizards, or what is it, Lucy lizards. In an early stage, when you haven't quite defined your product, when you don't know how your B2B sales work, it's hard to commit to a timeline, to a revenue target, to a product target, when you are actually adjusting. Obviously, you say, okay, if you invest with someone, it's always in good faith, and you tell them we will work it out. Chances are that the investor is not nice, partners change, associates change, whatsoever. So there's a misalignment in strength. Then, if your business is doing good, and that's what you refer to, if you're doing overly good, you can actually say, oh, well, I invest another, I give you the second tranche, whereas I would say, hey, our valuation on the private market would be actually much better. Yeah. So it's also, if it's going good, it's a proper de-risk for you.
Always a trade-off.
And in my experience, what we had in situations where people came to us and said, let's work with tranches, we said, I don't know, let's say we wanted a 10 million valuation. They said, hey, we give you on the first tranche, we give you 7, but on the second, we give you 13. And you make your math, and it's basically 9.8 in the end, because you have cost twice, blah, 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 blah. So it's not really, in my opinion, you never get the first tranche, the valuation, but you always have to make a discount. You always get a discount offered on the initial, on the first tranche, and then they want to compensate for the second one, which in the end, most of the time, costs you more and gives you more defocus. In the end, costs you more of your business.
Yeah, I think what can be, in a way, kind of, it could be a compromise could be reached. If you like the business, you know, one could agree in this very round to say, we allow you to invest at a, you know, a different valuation at a later stage. So once the company runs out of money and goes into fundraising, we have to ask you first, and you have kind of a first subscription right before everyone else if you like the company. Because what I've seen in the practice also is that you have a VC, the investment partner of the VC is very much in love with the company, but he leaves the VC, and all of a sudden his successor doesn't like the company so much. And then all of a sudden he decides, well, I had this once with a famous Berlin startup where an investor came in who was not from Germany, and who said, well, just sue me, you know, and then you're left with a certain run rate and your cash burn, and you don't have the time and the efforts to actually go to court on these. So you have to have waterproof documents, and you have to take all these things into consideration. And what we see sometimes is that founders are not experienced in these negotiations, and also they just think, okay, fine, I just want a signature and I want the check. But they don't really consider the ramifications it could have if it's not properly thought through.
Okay, thank you. I think we stop this here and we'll go and move in the next clause or the next provision we're talking about, or you will discuss about...
next investors coming at 8.
The liquidation preference, which is one of the most important economic term in the term sheet, I would believe. So guys, it's up to you again.
Liquid. Are we not with at first the vesting and VSOP?
I think as I tried to put it out in my introduction, I'd
okay.
Do it
well,
in three
if we
so
stick,
if you want to,
if we stick by the term sheet, then we just move on, and we kind of parked the investment amount to be paid in tranches versus a second right for subscription. I think the rest is simply mathematical and a manual for the lawyer who would ultimately have to draft the definitive documentation. When you see the post-closing capitalization, and we get to this also later when it comes to the ESOP, we have a definition of fully diluted, which means that everyone who participates in the distribution waterfall of the ultimate purchase price when the company is sold is being taken into consideration when calculating fully diluted. So when it means that Olaf's VC gets 20% on a fully diluted basis, which means if the exit price is 100, he gets 20. Even though there might be ESOPs, virtual stock option plans, employee incentive plans that come on top. And you have taken the approach here under the ESOP pool that you say the ESOP pool shall only dilute everyone else, but not you.
So this is your language. What I've meant is that the current ESOPs, which are already a part of it, already, let's say, allocated pre our round, 1,000 are already committed to a couple of employees. This ESOP pool should be generated before we invest. The next ESOP pools, because normally you don't, you know this, the first ESOP pool is just the first one. There will be a second, a third, a fourth. If the company is very successful, we will have various of ESOP pools. Sure, we will get diluted, but the ESOP pool, even in this stage of the company, and because Christoph and his co-founder already committed parts of the ESOPs to employees, needs to be allocated or needs to be generated before we invest. Sure.
Well, I think that your approach is fair only to the extent that it, it considers those who are already allocated. But what is not allocated is going to be allocated to someone after you have invested. So I think
and,
you should be
and
diluted.
You want to have the decision over someone.
You should be diluted by the by everything that's not allocated. So what we would do, we would take, we make a hard cut as to what's allocated, and then we erase all the unallocated ESOP and start a new ESOP the day you invest. So,
so what we can do here is we take the allocated ESOP, which you know is just allocated in a handshake between Christoph and his employees. We take this, and if it's an existing employee or existing founder who gets ESOPs in the next, let's say, 12 months, this will be taken from will be taken pre-round, because this is really not none of our business. Because this were decisions or situations before we invest.
Yeah, I think that's going to be a little bit difficult to differentiate, but more from a practical standpoint. But I think from a general concept, I think we can live with what's allocated, and I'm not sure if you want to allocate more to existing employees or if everything else will go to new employees.
It's good for now, but what we then have to look at is it goes in hand with the protective provisions that you basically have full control over who gets an ESOP share, and I would like
to... No, it's the board.
No, it's not the board. It's the investor's majority.
So we come to this later.
To let you know this. Yeah.
But, we're talking about the valuation, the dilution, and what I've said is employees who already exist and will get ESOPs or already got ESOPs, the dilution is not our part.
I would say the dilution is not your point on the promises we already made, but if we all agree on, and I think these three key employees are essential to the success of the business, and because of further dilution on later rounds, we would probably have to recompensate them. Mm. And I think this is for the overall good of the company that also these incentives should be carried by all investors and all future investors. So I would reckon we should just say, okay, the initial ESOP that we promised and haven't worked out yet legally, that's what we're going to cover as existing shareholders, and any other future ESOP, even existing employees, will be carried on.
Let's you provide an Excel spreadsheet or something like this with the names of the employees. how many virtual shares do you want to, let's say, allocate per employee, and the sum of it will be a virtual share option pool which will be generated pre-round. And I guess it will be about 2,000 shares or something like this.
May I intervene? Just a question. How large should an option pool be? How do you size it?
It depends on the round, on the stage of the company. And in the United States, for example, the option pools are much bigger than in Europe or in Germany.
You got some numbers?
In the United States, you have 20% option pools. And here... After an A round, you have a 10%, 12% option pool.
That's a lot.
This is still a lot, but because this 10% is triggered from us, because we know if a company really works out, and we have some good examples in our portfolio, that you will get the best talents on board, and you need options. So, but if the option pool is not enough... the board can decide together with the management to set up a new option pool. So it's not an option. We are talking about virtual shares. Do you know the difference between stock options and virtual shares? Virtual share, I'm not a lawyer, but it's a exit participation right. So it's not a voting right. Only in case of an exit, you will, or the VSOP, the virtual share option, will get exit participation.
It's basically a formula which is the underlying calculation for a bonus payment that you receive in case of the exit. So the major difference is that it's just a bonus, it's income, and it's fully taxed as income. So in Germany, you have 42 to 48% income tax on it. Whereas if you were a real shareholder and you would even hold it through a corporation, it would only have a tax burden of 1.5%. So the difference is very substantial on the taxation side, but just from an economic commercial side, what you get before tax is identical.
Not even if you have it in the holding, because then it's part of your employee contract and then can be deemed.
So just to sum it up, so when you start or when you get into a discussion, you assume that an option pool should be in place before you invest, so the dilution effect is carried out by the founders.
Now, we will get diluted by options anyway. Yeah? But if there is a company raising an A round and there's already a venture capitalist invested, Dark Side Ventures, yeah, normally, and a somehow experienced founder with a lawyer, there should be a little tiny option pool already, let's say, in place. And that's why we say, well, okay, if you have key employees and these key employees, let's say, got a commitment from you to get VSOPs in the last month or in the last 6 months, it's not our business. It's past.
So finally, two discussions or two points to discuss. Who takes the hit? And how big do you size the option
pool? Exactly. The future dilution, it's our business as well.
Right.
We will get diluted as any other, let's say, shareholder will get diluted. But the past, that's...
I mean, it also depends. You know, here we have two co-founders, but often in an investment round, in an early stage, the venture capitalist says there is a gap in the management. We need a CTO or an operative guy or a CFO.
Yeah.
And I only invest if this guy gets 5% of the equity. And then oftentimes the VC says, well, I don't want to be diluted by this because this is something that you should have done before. So that's if sometimes you see this gap in the management, and then that has a special provision.
But this is one situation.
To be fair.
And another situation is, especially here in Berlin, you have a lot of, let's say, incubated companies where the incubator has 60 or 70%, and the so-called founders have only 10%. I said, guys, you know, we are in an A round situation. After the C round, the so-called founders have only 5%, and there's no incentive for them. That's why we insist, before we invest in such a case, that the current shareholders will get diluted, that means the incubator, you know, not only a little bit, in order to generate this option pool, in order to incentivize the so-called founders.
But okay, to be fair, at Lieferando, we never had one investor asking for a... For an ESOP, for example.
Well, because you've got Jens as your lawyer, haven't you?
Yes.
So anyhow,
so it's, and in my new business also, it's sometimes it's there, sometimes investors. We had an investor at Lieferando who said, all the guys who should have shares have shares, and that's you founders. And I'm just saying it's in my experience, it's a discussion point, but it's...
Not that important.
My fundraising is history.
You had only employees in Germany. Look at, you know, the company we both know.
Sorry for interrupting you, before it gets heated, we can skip to the next point, which should be liquidation preference, or do you plan something else?
No, we're not quite there yet. advisory board.
Yes.
We believe that the founders are not yet willing to surrender their control of the company. So if we think, we still think an advisory board at this very early stage of the company is a little bit over the top. But if you want this in order to enforce certain control rights, we could agree to setting up an advisory board, but we would like to appoint two members. And you would appoint one member to the advisory board. And I think that's also fair, and you're also protected because at a later stage, further down the term sheet, we would be willing to give you certain veto rights for certain shareholders' decisions and for certain management decisions. But if we agree to an advisory board, again, I'm not sure we need this at this early stage. We'd like to control the board.
And one more thing, reasonably expensive members of the advisory board, as we can have board meetings or advisory board meetings over Skype, I think that should be cut off.
Yeah, you know,
I've seen cases, don't go to the nitty-gritty stuff.
At first, let's talk about the advisory board, whether we use Skype or WebEx. So advisory board, from our perspective, is very important in order to professionalize a company. Let's leave the shareholder matters away from the company, and let's take decisions between management and advisory board. I think it's a big advantage of U.S. companies that they really have a board, an operational board and a non-operational board. Makes them much faster than German companies, where you have to go back to the shareholders meeting and so on and so forth. That's why our experience and our wish is to push as much as possible from the shareholders area and shareholders table to the advisory board. And this advisory board should, let's say, be some kind of mirror of the shareholders. That means one advisory board member, we put at the table, the founders, and then I think it's very important to have one neutral guy maybe from the industry, and this guy has to be elected from all of us unanimously. And this advisory board, especially Christoph, in an early stage situation of a company, has to vote unanimously. So this, why? Because it's all about discipline and speed. You don't want to have politics in the advisory board. And if the advisory board has to agree unanimously, you have a real team, you know, behind you or against you. But then even your guy you have sent to the advisory board is on the same page.
Well, I think two things. You know, in general, the advisory board can help shortcut certain decision-making processes. I agree, you know, I think we could, you know, maybe compromise on saying we have one designation right, and we have the second designation, right, and you have a right to reject our second designee for cause. Or in other words, you cannot unreasonably not accept our second designee, but if you think there should be someone from the industry, or, you know, we can have a certain definition on that very person.
But yes, it's not all about us. You know, there are some other shareholders already at the table.
But
I think they want to.
But for them,
we can talk about the advisory board and look at also the protective provisions and giving us more flexibility upon contracts, hirings, etc., so that we don't have to actually get involved with the advisory board in for any, I don't know, 50, 60, 70,000 euro yearly contract.
Yeah, we'll come to the protective provisions later on, but this is, again, Christoph, this is really nitty-gritty stuff, the same like WebEx or Skype.
No,
at first,
not,
let's say,
not,
think about the...
Olaf, because if more decisions have to be brought into the advisory board, and actually, or the advisory board has more control than we want to give it, we can reduce the amount of control that the advisory board has on daily decisions by looking at cutting off protective provisions.
So I think shortcutting the discussion, I think we already have two people in mind, and we can share this with you. You can check them out. And if you're okay with it, then this point could be, we could move on.
So one guy comes from us, right. One guy from the founders. We are fine with this, whoever it is. Let me finish, please. And the third person, I think it's very important that even the angel pool and Dark Side Ventures are happy with the third guy. If you bring in buddies and friends, I don't know if this is good for the company. Why not asking everybody if your third guy your second guy is okay for everybody? Where's the problem?
Well, I think, you know, we agreed at the time when they invested that there was no advisory board. So it's now established for the first time. And
if they wanted an advisory board,
they have faith in the founders.
But they know that every angel and even Dark Side Ventures, they know that a company is getting professionalized after an A round, and then there will be an advisory board. The question is, who is elected as a third person? I think it's wise and fair to ask all the shareholders and all the investors if they're happy with the third guy.
But if you get everyone involved, you get an opinion from everyone. So
yeah, we take 80% of the votes.
Yeah, you can just do it by a shareholders meeting, voting with the meeting. So you need just regular shareholders majority, whatever. So it might be easy.
Yeah.
To just cut it short, to long story short. So the discussion about the advisory board is connected to the protective provisions by the end of the day, because this is something which gives you as an VC the chance to use your effective control and your power and to control your investment. Isn't that right?
Some points an investor has to control. In one sentence, Jens can explain this much better because he's a lawyer, but we say we have to have a veto. Every investor has a veto right in order to protect the preference rights of his shares. So if we invest, we get A round shares. And there, for example, a change of the article of the company, Satzung, could impact or put harm onto our shares. That means we have to protect our investment. It has nothing to do with control over the company. At first, we have to protect our investment. And these protective provisions are maybe 4 or 5, so that there are no other classes infecting or impacting our shares and so on and so forth. And then, you are right as well, there are some control clauses.
Okay.
But we have to differentiate between really protective and
so non-control. So we're going to skip on. So 2 points probably I take here. So protective provisions or even board decisions should not influence the daily business of the founders.
Sorry.
Well,
appendix three is basically what we're talking about.
Let's structure this for a moment. So you were talking about the shareholders, protecting your shareholding. So an investor wants to have a certain influence in the term sheet itself under protective provisions, page 6. The investor wants to make sure that even though he doesn't control the company because he doesn't have enough shares to vote as a majority, he wants a veto right for certain very major fundamental issues, such as changing the articles or increasing the capital, doing another financing round, et cetera, et cetera. So these are two things we have to differentiate. So in Germany, it's very formal to go through a process. If you don't have an advisory board, you have to send out an invitation to a shareholders meeting.
In time?
In time, it's at least 1 week, typically 2 weeks with a GmbH, with an AG, it's even a month. Then normally you have provisions that there's not a sufficient majority present, so you have to re-invite to the next board meeting. So somebody could simply slow down a shareholders meeting and shareholders' decision by simply not showing to the shareholders' meetings. So that's why it makes absolute sense to structure it in a way that certain basic decisions are being designated from the shareholders to the advisory board. So the manager, Christoph, only has to go to his board and ask for approval, and then that also is okay on a shareholders' level. So that being said, the composition of the advisory board is pretty important because Olaf could, if he controlled the advisory board with a 20% shareholder, he could pretty much block a vast amount of major decisions on a management level and on the shareholders level. So that's why this control, in practice, I've actually hardly ever seen a dispute where there was not unanimous consent among the board members, but sometimes in the later the company, the more the company matures, at a later stage it gets, the more often it could happen that there are different strategic aspects, or an investor starts to hold everybody else hostage simply because he wants out and he wants to sell his shares, and he uses leverage that he has under the shareholders agreement to corner the others, to let him out. And so it's really important at an early stage to make sure that there's a balance among the shareholders that creates as little as possible on leverage on one particular side.
Because basically the terms that you negotiate now set in precedent for any future rounds.
It draws a line in the sand, but anyhow, we should move forward, otherwise we're losing time.
Right.
Yeah. So one statement.
One last word,
If I look into the tail mirror, back in 2005, I founded my last own company, and I got a very bad advice from my VCs about the board. And the board and the setup of the board really put harm onto my company. I had no industry guys there, only investors, and a very slow decision-making process. And the investors had different, let's say, intentions, because different funds in different fund cycles. And that's why I'm so keen about this discipline in the board. So I've got the T-shirt. I made very bad experiences as a founder. And that's why I try to avoid a five or even bigger board, five people or even more.
Okay, so it might that these provisions, either in board or protective provisions, may protect the VCs.
Both, but
not necessarily from their own.
Exactly, yeah.
or from themselves.
But since it's a rather minor point, I think, just in the essence of time, let's move on.
Well, it's a discussion. Yeah. Anyway, so, guys, you're again. It's your part.
So,
which one is it?
You know, Olaf, we were very surprised to see your proposal of a participating two times liquidation preference, which we find very much not being the market standard, very much over the top. And, you know, at the end of the day, what we see in the market today is pretty much only a so-called non-participating liquidation preference, which provides you with a downside that you actually want to have. If the company, for whatever reason, should be sold in a fire sale at a price less than what you paid for, you first get your money back.
But does everyone know how liquidation preferences work?
I could give you just a simple example to see what the pain of the investor may be.
Who start with a participating liquidation preference. So what does this mean? You sell the company, and then the distribution waterfall is calculated. And the distribution waterfall, in this case, would mean first, Olaf would get two times his money back, so 2 million. And if he still has 20% in the company, he would
for
then,
10 million price,
he would then participate in the remainder of the distribution with his full 20% stake, which is a very high over-optimization. And sometimes you see this in later rounds where there's no investor, the company has certain traction, but only one investor comes in, he realizes his leverage and forces this so-called participating liquidation preference.
So, but how this proposal is on the table. How do you argue against Olaf's proposal?
Is your business model making money out of liquidation preferences?
So
or
our business
making
model
money
now
as a shareholder of a business.
Okay.
What's your business?
So now I'm defending, yeah, but don't get me wrong here. I wouldn't offer this, but I can defend this.
It's your term sheet.
Yeah. So look, your company hasn't sold anything. Yeah. Your business model is to sell something and to earn money out of it, right? And therefore, you got angels on board, you got dark side ventures on board, and you need another investor on board to get your product ready, to hire salespeople, and to get out of the blocks, hit the ground running. And we are willing to invest. But our business model is we have a 1.5 billion fund, we can invest each particular euro in this fund only one time. And we need to get in minimum a 3x on every invested euro. Otherwise, we can't go back to our investors and ask for another fund, and because we are not performing. So let's take the case that we invest 1 million, we own 20%, and the company will get sold in a fire sale because your product won't scale, but we can sell the assets, or you can sell the asset of the company, the technology, and you sell it for, let's say, 5 million. Yeah? So if you sell it for 5 million, we will get two times our money and 600,000 on top of it. Right?
Yes. But
okay. So this is still a bad deal for us. But how much money will you get out of a 5 million fire sale? So company didn't work, product is not sellable. You still have about 50% amongst the, no, 70% amongst all founders, you will get 3 million, about 2 million. Even if the company never, never went out of the blocks.
No.
So that's why a participating liquidation preference in case of a non-working, not scalable company, which I don't think so, because we have done our homework, but it can happen, is absolutely fair enough.
Okay, two things. First of all, an investment is always a leap of faith, so you have to have some trust in our business and not just work on downside provisions. What will happen now is you want a 2x liquidation preference. The first 500K in the business is going to want a 2x liquidation preference. So that will be another 1 million we have in front of us. What
Why?
Will happen?
Well, the seed shares, they don't have a...
100% guarantee you they will come and will ask for the same provisions. So this will... This is true now. This real life experience. This is what's going to happen. The old ones,
especially future investors.
First of all, the old ones will say and will drag you in a corner and say, "Hey, I want the same provisions." But let's make a calculation as Lucy Lizards now. Going forward, we have someone investing 20 million into the business, and we're just going to exit for 100 million with a 2x liquidation preference participating. What will happen is, we sell for 100 million, that investor gets 40 million. In the end, we have, these are 60 million left. Then you get your money back. Then the seed investors get their money back. And in the end, we will end up having a business which was worth 100 million.
Yeah.
We will have sold it we will get 50 million. I get only 25 million out of it.
Christoph, shows me that you have never talked about B rounds or C rounds.
Never did it vanish
if you go to a growth round.
That's what you tell me. I've never raised financing in my life, so how would I know?
I mean, to your point, you know, we're at the A round level. So if we now agree to a participating liquidation preference, the likelihood is very great that everybody else who comes in a B or C round will say, we want the same thing.
Can I finish one point?
So what will happen, Olaf? What will happen if we have if we sell for 100 million and we... Who muted me? If we sell for 100 million and there is a 20 million... investment in our business, the actual amount of, you're not making 20% out of 100 million diluted, but you'll make your shares, you only make money out of 60 million. So the broader impact going forward for you is much bigger than the short-term downside protection
I got your point, but you are, you think that in a growth round, in a B or C round, these, liquidation preferences will be just copied. This is not true.
Yeah, they will increase.
No, this is not true because the existing shareholders and especially the existing investors won't, stick to the participating or double dip liquidation preferences. If the company is really growing, if we go to a B or C round with a growth investor, our lick pref will vanish anyway. So because we will go to the growth investor and say, guys, one-time lick pref, non-participating. And all the other preferences of the A, C, and maybe if there's a B round in between, will have in one-time lick pref. So that means the preference rights of the old shares will be changed if the company is working well. If not, absolutely sure, it's a downside protection for us.
That's all in the future.
We are talking only about future revenues, about your future product.
I don't trust you with your experience. Everyone can tell me anything about this. What's going to happen. What we see in the US currently is huge rounds with incredible high liquidation preferences. But this is what's happening. So what about we do something, I know it's going to be a bit complicated, but I think Jens will write it in no time. We have a one-time participating liquidation preference, but only up to a certain exit.
So a vanishing one.
Yeah. So we have
or a fading out
we
one.
Have a threshold, and basically, what also will happen if we say we raise a round on, I don't know, 20 million euros pre-next round, that liquidation preference will vanish no matter what the exit
is. Okay, let's do the following. We take a one-time lick pref
participating,
but it will vanish between 8 and 10 million.
All right. That's
okay, okay. So anyhow,
can you do that, Jens?
Whatever you do, I think to conclude this discussion,
was good.
Every entrepreneur just simply should do the math. That's all what it's about. And so let's give it a break and skip to the next provision in this term sheet, which might be the dividend preference, which is you don't want to discuss that. Okay, so let's skip
it
to the
one last point. You know, even though this sounds like now a reasonable compromise. Don't forget, every next investor sees this full documentation, and you always negotiate against what has been agreed in the former round. And it's really hard to argue against something that you had already agreed previously. So that's just from a negotiating standpoint a disadvantage, you know, because you just they want to say, well, we'll copy and paste the same clause for the next liquidation preference, and we increase the thresholds for as when the liquidation preference vanishes. So that's the downside, which why in reality we would fight this point much harder, and which why in reality reasonable VCs don't even make that proposal.
So actually, you just say keep it simple. As simple as possible.
I think I have to underline this, what Jens mentioned. Terms and conditions will be inherited.
Stapled upon.
To the next round. This is very important. So make sure that there is no tricky point in it. But on the other hand side, all the terms we are talking about now, all the terms and conditions are, let's say, trade-offs against each other. You know, if Christoph and his team doesn't want to get diluted that much, but even though they are in a very early stage, they want to have a high valuation, the investors need a little bit higher, let's say, downside protections. So it's really kommunizierende Röhren, whatever that means, trade-offs.
But as you know, I've got investors lined up, so...
Well, bring them in.
It's okay. Give it a break.
1 hour.
I think...
Yeah, so the same, I mean, dividend preference would be the next point, something that you would typically not see in a term sheet at all or in a shareholders agreement. We put it in there just for completion purposes. In a very few rounds, in very special circumstances, you create a dividend preference, which means typically startups like these don't distribute dividends ever before they get sold, because they reinvest the money, they rely on external financing, and they are set up to be sold within 5-6 years down the road. So they would ideally never pay dividends, which is why you would typically not find this provision, but as I said, in certain circumstances, you would find those, but they would not be acceptable. The way it's proposed here is that the investors get all the dividends and the shareholders do not. So where does this come from? Maybe a little excursion comparison to the Anglo-American system. The Anglo-American system is much simpler than ours because it has two classes of shares, common shares and preference shares. Typically, everybody who gives sweat into the company, who works for the equity, gets common shares, and everybody who puts money in the company gets preferred shares. So that's why you don't need all these complicated issues in a UK or a US company, because the investors will always have preference shares, so they only have the voting rights and they control the company through the preference. In Germany, you have to put, in order to come to a similar setup, you have to put very substantial provisions in the articles and the shareholders agreement, which is why this term sheet is much longer than it would be in a US company. It would be about 2 pages long, and here we have 10. You know, so that's maybe a little bit of the background explanation of where we're coming from.
I missed one point I wanted to do, to bring up in the first let's say first step of our discussion, and this is Thomas. Did you read this this setting the stage and background paper? Thomas is a guy we really don't like. And Thomas is a guy who always pops up in setups of unexperienced founders. A guy who has common shares and is not working for the company.
But tells people that just his name will get you better introductions and more
what
credibility
we would do,
in the market.
Berlin is full of them.
Yeah, Berlin, and be aware of these guys. We would fight with a knife between our teeth to get him out or to get him diluted in favor of an option pool, in favor of the founders, because he's non-operational, he has common shares, so he's a founding angel, whatever that means. So just wanted to make this point because it's very important.
Yeah, so, by the other way, it's, you shouldn't pay with your shares anybody for some services they offer to you.
Never ever.
Never ever. Yeah. So shares is not a currency, but I know what you would like
no, I
to
think
say.
It's not in here in the term sheet, but we placed this Thomas guy in there for this reason, because you see a lot of business angels, in especially in Berlin, who help, who say, well, we can make intros, we help you make intros to investors, especially this kind of stuff. You know, lately there has been two guys that have that sit on a huge amount of domain names, and they give away these domain names for free to the company for 10% of the equity.
Great deal.
And they prove unbelievably difficult down the road if you don't keep them under control. So today, especially in e-commerce, domain names have become a very precious good, and the name of a company is often decided upon which domain name on a .com top level is free. And since these become more and more rare, these guys can actually make a business. And they have a huge amount of stock of domain names.
So in particular
available.
In Berlin, beware of these
guys.
These guys. So anybody
rather pay the money to
right.
pay them out than
either you pay money or you work for the company, but everything else you shouldn't accept as a founder, because that becomes really pain in the ass, as you explained for the moment. So the next clause or the next provision we have is the so-called anti-dilution provision, which is, I believe, one of the hardest to discuss provision part of the economic terms. So before we dive into Jens, probably you would keep or you would like to give a short explanation how that works, and Olaf, you may explain why VCs probably insist on kind of that provision.
Yeah, I mean, at the end of the day, it's a downside protection where if the company does a financing round at a lower valuation than this, then the VC says, well, actually, when I invested at a valuation that was too high, and I should have invested also under lower valuation. So in order to make up for that, that investor would want the founders or the other shareholders to make up for the difference. So he doesn't get some money back, but he gets additional shares to put him in the position as if he had invested at the lower valuation, which is subsequent to this financing round. So this is an absolute standard term, and I personally believe it's fair, but there are a number of issues that need to be taken into consideration. Number one is how is this downside protection, this anti-dilution calculated? And it's called, usually we see what's called a weighted average calculation, or is it a full ratchet calculation? The other thing is we want, typically you see a scenario of a down round only if a company is struggling, if it's not doing so well. So it's actually in need for capital. So we would want only an investor to enjoy the rights of these anti-dilution provisions who's also willing to invest in this down round. So these are the things, these are the two things you negotiate in this context. The so-called pay-to-play provision. So we would say, well, Olaf, we're more than happy to give you an anti-dilution right if we do a subsequent financing round. But number one, only the next financing round, not 5 years later. And only if you agree to also invest pro rata to your share holding in this down round. And yep. We would want to have a... a weighted average calculation of the anti-dilution down round price. Yeah.
So the thing I would like to defend here, just because it's very complicated, is pay-to-play is fine, because I'm absolutely in favor of pay-to-play clauses, which are rare in Germany. Yeah. In United States, you always have pay-to-play.
Basically means you lose most of your rights as an investor if you don't participate.
Yeah, but I hope this will only apply for VCs, because if you're an angel investor, you don't have that deep pockets.
It there was a case in Berlin right now.
But then you don't enjoy the anti-dilution.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
So,
if I start as an angel investor to discuss and get an anti-dilution, why should I lose that right because I don't have that deep pockets as an angel investor which has 1.5 billion?
But you participate only on the next round, and if the next round is below the current round, and you don't, I mean, it's always pro rata, so we probably get someone new in. Let's say we have a 10 million round, we now do it, oh, this round is on a 4 million, we do a round on a 2 million, it's only pro rata, we might get a new guy in, so that gives you, I know that Darkside Ventures has to pay, I know, 30 grand. If you don't have 30 grand, you cannot participate. That's,
I think,
that they always lose somewhere.
The tricky part, the tricky part in this clause here is we want to have a full ratchet, and not weighted average. And so why should we, let's say, go away from our full ratchet clause? We exist pay to play, sure. We invest in the next round.
But that's rare. I mean, in practice, I don't see many VCs accepting pay-to-play. But I think that's a very important provision.
Yeah. So that means we can stick to full ratchet, but pay-to-play.
Yeah.
All right. Well, I've seen in another business that's real life. the investor who came in a down round said, I'm only going to invest if... the old investors are losing their rights or they participate. Right. So they made the pay-to-play provision wasn't in the initial shareholders agreement, but it was part of the new agreement that the old investors had to participate pro rata. They didn't. Now they don't even get...
As an angel investor, I would never sign such a clause. Then.
This is life.
Typically, the company is in a corner when it comes to a down round, and so are the shareholders. So if you don't have to pay to play, what will happen eventually is that one of your existing shareholders says, well, I will rescue the company, but I will only rescue all your other guys' investment if you also participate. Mm-hmm. So I dictate the terms. If you don't participate, you lose maybe even more rights than under pay to play. Like, for instance, liquidation preference rights and so forth. And that's when something, you know, this white knight who steps in and says, I'm going to rescue the company, but I'm not going to rescue all of your investment with my money. I want 2x. Liquidation preference. That's when these kind of issues are being negotiated, because then the investor, who's the only one that puts money on the table, has the leverage to do so.
Really short side terms, and by the end of the day, I could tell you some stories about that.
I've seen it.
Yeah, I've seen it too. Yeah, but the final discussion as an angel investor just doesn't sign any contract anymore. So the company said,
and that's why listen to it. That's why very important. angel pools. Yeah, what does it mean? Maybe Jens can bring this over much better. Why is it so important for a company to have not on the cap table particular, you know, personal business angels? Why do you have, you should pool the business angels?
And you see that in Berlin a lot. If you look at cap tables, there are, I have a cap table from a business where I'm like also 0.0 something. I know there are like 30 people on the list. And every time they need something, they need 30 approvals.
I mean, it's not really, today, unfortunately, you can no longer pool them in a
easy way,
as easily as you used to, you know, because it's the same, the KGB problem with certain regulatory approvals being necessary. But what you should have is a voting right pooling. So you actually say that in your shareholders agreement, everybody typically who has less than 5%. Gives the founder or someone else, another trustee, shareholder, an irrevocable proxy, so he can vote and execute his shareholder his shareholding rights. So that if you want to get a shareholder's approval, and some guy is hiking on the Kilimanjaro and has 0.1% in a company, you're screwed because it slows you down on the timeline substantially. So that's why you need these pooling arrangements if you have a lot of very small shareholders in the company.
Okay, thank you. Does everybody know what vesting means? Jens, would you like to step in and just explain in brief what vesting agreements are about?
So, welcome back, everyone. It's the vesting is something that it's a mean to incentivize the founders to stay in the company and to punish them should they leave the company before the company is sold, or they're actually good to leave the company. So typically an investor comes in and he invests in the team, most importantly, and he invests in the business idea. If the team for some reason gets into a fight, one of the team members, one of the founders leaves, or even both founders decide they no longer want to continue, all the investors' money is in jeopardy. So the way they try to punish the founders and to make sure they discipline themselves is through the vesting. So typically what you see is a vesting depending on the maturity of the company. Here we have a company that's about 1 year old. It's been started a year ago by the founders. It had a few investments by angels and is now in its A round. So that means it probably has 4 or 5 years to go before the company gets sold, and probably 3 years to reach a certain level where the company can hopefully, when it's managed properly, run on its own without the full founders team. So you want to say something, or you want to implement something where you, where the founders who leave before these 3 years, or that point in time has been reached where the company can be run on its own because it has sufficient traction, you want to implement some punishment so that the founders loses his shares if he still decides to leave. So unfortunately, we've seen cases where those vesting provisions have been triggered in the past. Mostly it was because the founders no longer got along with themselves, or one founder had something happening in his personal life. But in practice, these vesting provisions sometimes come to life. So the way it is suggested here is that in case a founder leaves within the first year, he loses all his shares. And after that, he would vest quarterly, which means over a period of 3 additional years, so 4 years in total. After year one, every quarter, a certain amount of his shares vest, which means if the company gets sold and he's no longer with the company, that vested part of his shares he gets to keep. So from a founder's perspective, they will certainly argue, as I will do now to Olaf, who has put this provision in here, that the founders have already built themselves and they should actually be entitled to keep their shares. But let's not kid ourselves. Of course, in practice, this is an absolute standard term.
And if I may join, as a founder, I'm also a big fan of these vesting clauses because it basically protects you in a business. It's not about, always think about not yourself, but what if you get in a fight with your co-founder and he leaves the business after 2 years? He owns, I don't know, he has 25%. He leaves. He still owns 12.5%, probably takes another 5 to 6 years until your business is ready for acquisition, making money, whatever. But these 12.5% do really matter. So I actually wouldn't even argue against that. I would say that's fine.
So I think at the end of the day, we would probably cut the 48 months down to 36 months. And we would agree on an accelerator, which means if the company gets sold before the vesting period is over, the founder, of course, is entitled to all of his shares if he's still with the company. That is just a clarification I would put in there, but I assume that's what is meant.
So, accelerated vesting. Is it on now?
No, it's off. No, he's off.
Okay.
So can you hear me? Yeah. So accelerated vesting, absolutely agreed. It's just missing in this clause. And as a side note, in one of my last investments some years ago, we have had this situation. Four founders, and 3 months after investment round, three founders came to me and said, Olaf, we've got a problem. We want to get rid of one. So without vesting, the shares would have gone as well. And with the vesting clause, we found an agreement. So it's really, as Christoph has mentioned, it's not only protection for the VC, it's really a protection and a downside protection for the company and for the other founders.
Friend of mine.
So it's more or less an alignment tool between the founders, because if one leaves within the first year, he gets a free ride if you build it up for $1 billion.
I know very little experienced founders who are, I know none who are against vesting clauses.
By the way, we as a VC, we have this vesting clauses as well. So we have investors as well, and they insist on vesting clauses too. So if we leave after, let's say, 5 years, and the fund term is 10 or 12 years, we will lose our part of our economics as well.
So, you know, as always, the devil is in the detail, and you will see something in these vesting clauses that you will see also in ESOPs, which is called a good lever, bad lever clause. So that means you will probably agree to the vesting in principle, but you may want to negotiate what's the definition of a bad lever. And the easiest definition is always to say, well, a bad lever is somebody who has been terminated, who has caused the company or the others to terminate him, and he has delivered some kind of cause. And everything that's not by cause is a good lever event. And in a good lever event, he gets to keep his shares. So it's all about the bad lever, and since German law is relatively broad, and it's pretty much if you don't steal from the company, you can't be terminated for cause. So it's very strict as to when such termination for cause can actually apply. You usually end up with maybe half page long bad lever definitions in these agreements, and that is then up to the detail and the definitive documentation. It would lead too far at this very stage, but whenever it's about vesting, reverse vesting, or ESOP, because all the employee stock option plans come also with a vesting, then you always have these good lever, bad lever provisions in there.
Questions we have afterwards.
So there's a Q&A session then. But anyway, would you say that is pretty much standard, a good lever, a bad lever discussion,
yes,
or a provision?
Yes, even say as a founder.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Do you necessarily need it? And what is the benchmark? Is the bad lever the benchmark or the good lever?
I think a bad lever benchmark is, you know, and I'm probably exceeding my role as the defense of the founders here, but I think if something happens, no matter what, that makes it impossible for everyone else to work with this person, then the bad lever clause should be triggered. You know, this can be, you know, I've seen cases. This is not a joke. Many years ago, I was on the board of a company where one founder slept with the girlfriend of the other founder. So, does this make him a bad lever? Probably not. But it made it impossible for the remaining founder to ever work with this person again. So, what do you do? You know. So I was in the awkward position as the board member to have to mediate between them and find a solution.
What was a solution, just for curiosity?
The
other one slept with the other girl.
So it's just change of women.
Okay, sometimes you become a psychiatrist more than a lawyer, but... very often the details you need to try to cover, and oftentimes you cannot cover them in a legal language, and you have to deal with them in real life when you cross that bridge, and hopefully you.
Now, for example, bad lever, if a founder is not willing to work for the company anymore. Yeah? So normally it's not a bad lever because it's not for cause. But if he says, well, I'm not going to, let's say, sign another contract, if the contract is, has a term of 2 years, then we would call this a bad lever event.
Okay, there's not pretty much a discussion about that topic in particular with Christoph.
Probably as an inexperienced founder.
You're not experienced in this part here.
I don't
really
like that.
Inexperienced.
because the next investor is coming in 30 minutes. as an inexperienced founder, I would spend a lot of time on it, and that's what we did at the beginning, at Lieferando. Looking back, it's actually a point that you can pretty much skip.
Good.
So don't use it as leverage in negotiation. Go like you don't want that, and then trade it in for something else. But don't really sweat on it.
So would you trade it against someone? Trade it in for some protective provision? We already touched this.
Board valuation. ESOP.
Now we already touched the protective provisions. But if you, as a founder, experienced founder or non-experienced, whatever role you like to take, would you accept all of these protective provisions and implement or insert in this term sheet?
I would probably go back to how the voting happens. A lot of the things here are standard, which are with the preemption right, take a long right, drag a long right, which kind of work together, where I would not agree on.
The protective provisions, sorry if I interrupt you, but
you're
doing is what a lot of people do. They skip the protective provisions as it's just some small print. It's actually, most of it is, and most of it is a given, but if you take, for instance, Roman 3 here, where, you know, assume you agree to give your investor a veto right over every capital increase. He could essentially decide whether or not you need another round of financing. Or he could essentially decide, well, you may need another round of financing, but I'm going to be the only one who's going to give you the money. Otherwise, I'm not going to accept this. I'm going to veto your capital increase. Because essentially, every equity-based financing is also a capital increase. So... in this little Roman 3, you actually want to have a caveat in there which allows you to do further fundraising and issue shares, which by nature, because they're issued later, will be senior to the Series A shares. and you don't want to allow the investor to hold you hostage on future financing rounds. So the investor is protected because he has a subscription right, which means he can always subscribe to as many shares as he needs to in order to stay at the same equity level. So he does not dilute. So if he has 20% now and you do another capital increase, he can always subscribe to as many shares so he doesn't lose the 20%. But beyond that, you need to be allowed to go out and raise additional capital. So that caveat in Little Roman 3, we would want some language that enables us to raise further capital even, and you cannot veto that for as long as you have your statutory subscription rights.
I think point three, yes and no. We need to have some kind of shareholders voting, and because it's not possible that just the founder is, let's say, going out and raising any kind of investment round. That's why we have a shareholders meeting, or we have shareholders. That's why we have a board. We can leave our sole veto right, and we have to calculate that, for example, the majority or 75% of all preference shares, which are which is the angel pool, Dark Side Ventures, and our shares, have to vote or have a veto right.
Why don't we go all shareholder majority? Because we as founders only have 48 after the round. We could go with a. So my concern is that you will.
Yeah, I think
we go 75%
shareholder. What would happen if there was no such provision? Then it goes back to the law, and the law would require a 75% majority for a capital increase.
Yeah.
So then we have to look at the cap table, who controls 75% and how could the mechanics work. And the cap table here...
If we have 20% fully diluted and we have an option plan...
Founders have 48%.
Yeah, so
let's say we have about 23, 24, maybe 23% non-diluted.
Non-diluted, yes. So you could not alone, so you would have to bring another shareholder
at
on board.
At least Dark Side Ventures or the Angel Pool.
Yeah, and you know, in the end of the day, it's always in the best interest of the company.
Yeah.
But you just want to make sure that there's no situation created where one shareholder can hold you hostage. So
but then let's do one thing, because we
if
have
they had if they yeah, had 30% and you would have no provision, then they had a statutory veto.
Yes, we have the liquidation preference who's vanishing on a 10 million pre. Let's say they cannot veto any capital increase below 10 million. Because otherwise they just want you. I don't know. You believe.
I think this is too complicated. Let's.
Well, this is something which like, I would say you can veto on a
you know, normally you would have something in there where
below a certain round
where you cannot veto if you know if it's in accordance with the company's financial needs and so forth, and you waive your subscription rights or you decide not to invest, then we have to be free to issue to go out and raise more capital from somewhere else. Okay.
So I'm cutting here. I think you've discussed it and you agreed in some way or the other. So let's go to the next one, which is, according to the term sheet, let's skip the subscription right, but probably go to the audit information rights, which is always kind of a discussion with founders.
Really?
Yeah, sometimes they do. Yeah.
I mean, the subscription
very,
right,
very early
information. I mean, the subscription right is statutory, so it cannot be waived. But typically, English or American investors want that in there because they don't know the German law, so they would insist that they can actually invest in every financing round going forward.
Yeah, well, in very early stage, very unexperienced founders, they do discuss about all this information rights, because what is their fear is just that they most of the day spend in producing some kind of nasty reports to send it over to the VCs, which is... in practice not true. But isn't it something which may be considered then, or?
I have never discussed audits and information rights. I think it's important that no investor should insist to have one of the big four doing the auditing in the first years, because it's just cash-wise overkill and resource-wise. And then the information right.
I think it's
straightforward.
It's turning more into a. Experience sharing here.
Yeah.
But information, I think if you commit to like a 30 days information on like that you inform, keep your investors informed, actually gives you investors a lot of confidence in working with you, even though it's not going good, or if it's, especially when it's not going good. So I think just for yourself, it's a good thing to have that 30 day review of your internal business, or of your business, how it's going, who did you hire, highlights, low lights, where can investors help? What will happen if you do that in a good way, that when things get bad, investors are more likely to help you and give you a bridge loan and help you with some bridge financing or a loan or whatever, because they felt involved in the business, and they might see things coming earlier than you because they've seen it before. So I think actually the 30 days reporting is, we try to do it in our new business. We now skip to 60 days every 2 months because we found it's a bit too much work. But in detail, it's quite good that you, for yourself. So you should, if you don't want to do it for the investor, do it for yourself. And then just share that result with your investor, because you get your co-founders on board, you get your head of product, IT, whatever. They feed you the information. You get basically a diary of your company's performance.
I think this is a great statement to
thank you.
Hop to the next provision.
From an unexperienced founder, not
from an unexperienced founder, never seen and never done it before.
No, I'm just saying we hated it, but.
It disciplines you to a certain degree, and it helps you, better visualize where your company stands. And I agree.
So that's okay, don't do it for the investor. Do it for yourself. Good. Use it as a bargaining point.
What about the restriction of transfer? Do you accept these kind of provisions? Well, as an unexperienced founder, or you as an experienced lawyer of an unexperienced founder?
Well, at the end of the day, in a German GmbH, every share transfer as a default needs to be approved by the shareholders' meeting. So a majority of the shareholders. So here, you in the shareholders' agreement, you give the shareholders certain rights. Excuse me, certain rights and duties when they want to sell their shares. And we'll get to that in a minute. But if a shareholder goes through all the hurdles, gives the right of first refusal, offers certain shareholders to tag along, then there is the obligation to approve that sale.
I have one point. As you all have read the introduction, and here in this particular case, and we see this in many cases, not Christoph is the owner of his shares. His investment vehicle is the owner, and all the protection provisions must apply to the founder's investment vehicles. Why? The Christoph UG is the shareholder. He could sell the shares of the UG or a GmbH, whatever it is, to any other person. That would mean he would, let's say, bypass all the protective provisions. And that's why that's very important that the restriction of transfer applies to the investment vehicles of the founders.
Then you
and I want to have this in here.
But then you have to get in a majority, like a change of control, which is also something because you could sell 99% of your company and of your holding, still have 1%, so you're technically still a shareholder, but have no control over the things. So that we saw that only at the very latest stage that people looked at that, probably an experience, I don't know. But this is actually something you can use later as a bargaining chip.
Yeah. Well, you actually don't only want the restriction for the transfer. You no, actually everything. Want the change of control, which yeah. could also happen by way of a capital increase. You know? Yeah. So you want to have a catch-all. And in many instances, this is also penalized in the agreement. A lot of investors had bad experiences with circumvention, so that has become a very important clause in yeah. these agreements.
And if you see secondary shareholders, like people having shareholdings in certain businesses in Berlin, where you think, how can that guy have an investment in that music business with the orange logo? Then you're like, okay, how did that happen? It happened because these provisions weren't in, and somebody sold through his shareholding and just let him sub-participate in. So,
or they just simply ignore these clauses and wait what happened.
Or you do that.
Exactly, that won't happen yeah. in some cases. So anyway.
So it's a big thing.
Maybe we can go to a section which is more controversial.
Which
it's getting boring.
We're running out of time. I think we shall probably focus on two further provisions, which would be drag along and the reps and warranties. Probably
and fees and expenses.
And fees.
And fees, yeah, well, in particular. But that's the
I really
thing.
Like this.
You like the fee discussion.
I like the fee discussion.
Before you start discussing about the fees, you better discuss about a drag along, right?
Sorry, I have to get it.
So just, Jens, before you guys start to discuss it without the founder, just brings up some details. What is drag along about? And probably all of you can say why you need it.
So before a company gets sold, everybody wants to have certain provisions in place that protect yourself, to protect yourself from somebody just selling out and maybe making some money, but you cannot participate in it. Also, you want protection from somebody selling to a competitor, somebody selling to a third party, and all of a sudden you have a new shareholder on the table that you don't know and you maybe don't want to have in there. So the first provision you have here, the preemption right, it's called here, it should rather be called right of first refusal, is that in case somebody wants to sell his shares, first he has to offer his shares to all other shareholders. So that right of first refusal provision, for instance, in America, is subject to an entire whole agreement because it's rather extensive. And it governs, so I want to sell, I offer it to my 10 co-shareholders, out of which 5 say, okay, I want to buy your shares. The other 5 say, I don't want to buy the shares. Then the others say, well, we want to catch up and we want to buy all the remaining shares, or we don't want to buy the remaining shares. What happens then, and when can you sell actually to the third party? So all of these are provisions that make this right of first refusal clause several pages long. And ideally, all of your shares will be bought by existing shareholders and not by a third party. So the second protection is the tag-along, so the co-sale right. So it has two serves two purposes. The one purpose is to say, there's the secondary fund and he offers a good valuation and I can sell some of my shares, so I want to participate in it as well. So somebody sells 10% of his shares, he has to go to everybody else and say, do you want to participate pro rata in the sale of my shares to this secondary fund? So you can actually enjoy a certain cash in as well. The other purpose is it also serves as a poison pill. So you don't want necessarily the secondary to go through. You don't want your co-shareholder to sell to somebody. So everybody else can go together and say, well, we all use our tag-along rights. So at the end of the day, if he has 5% in the company, he wants to sell his shares. Everybody else says, okay, we want to sell 5% as well. And then all of a sudden, his portion in the secondary gets so small that it becomes economically irrelevant. So it acts as a poison pill, and you want to make sure that it serves all parties. So that's why even founders are not opposed to tag-alongs per se. But you negotiate if you, as a founder, are also entitled to tag-along. Because what this says here is that only the preference shareholders are entitled to tag-along, whereas we as founder representatives or founder would say, no, this should actually apply to everybody. And so at the tag-along right, we believe this should apply to everybody. And the tag-along is always kind of counterparted by the drag-along. So the drag-along is you have the possibility to force your co-shareholders under certain preconditions to sell their shares. And that is important because a buyer eventually will only want to buy 100% in the company, and he doesn't want 5%, 20% minority shareholder in the company that just causes him pain down the road. So you want to make sure that the drag-along is also in there, and again, the way it's structured here, where only the lead investor can trigger the drag-along, is not acceptable. So typically, you see in a drag-along either a certain minimum period in which at least the founders cannot be dragged, and you see a certain minimum threshold of valuation under which no drag-along exists. So that often comes with other downsides. And for instance, you can be held hostage because everybody wants to sell, but the drag-along threshold is just barely not reached. So one can say, well, I'm not going to let myself drag unless everybody else buys me or pays me so much that my drag-along threshold is reached. And we've experienced that kind of investor behavior before, unfortunately. So it has to. These are clauses that have to be very well thought through, and they can cause you trouble down the road if you don't pay close attention.
Sounds reasonable from a point of view if you represent the entrepreneur. Olaf, what's your experience?
Yeah, but I would still say the lead investor should not have the only, so in this case, the lead investor solely can drag. My experience, what we have is that someone can drag, and you have what's not in here, but you have a time window where also the investors or any other shareholders, even in a drag, can buy the investor out. So Olaf says, okay, I have an offer for 10 million. I'm going to drag you all. You all have to buy it for 10. We can buy Olaf out at a 10 million valuation. So we don't have to sell, but we buy him out if he has a valid offer, which also sometimes, what happens sometimes is if somebody wants to get out, he gets an offer saying, okay, look, guys, here's the 10 million I want out. I want us to take the offer. He knows none of the other people want to get out but have to follow on that offer. So it's kind of, you can also use that as a pretty big bargaining, and we had that.
Why is a drag-along right very important for an investor? I think this is the question here. Simply said, an investor is in a relationship with a company or with the founders for a period of time. Our business case is to invest and within 5, 7, 10 years to de-invest. That means to sell the company or to sell our shares of the company or in the company. And that's why we need this drag right to trigger this sell of our shares. And sometimes a buyer wants to get the entire company, or sometimes only our part of the shares. So that's why, you know, this provision here, it's very strict. And as Jens mentioned before, normally there are two or three, say, trigger points in a drag write clause, which enables us to trigger the drag write immediately. For example, I would insist, so we are investing on Christoph. So Christoph and his co-founder. And if one of these guys leave, our drag write will be triggered, because we are investing in these guys. If one of these guys is hit by a truck or is going to leave the company, we want to have the right to drag immediately. Then after a period of time, and this is very important for us, we need to have the right to drag. And this is what we can negotiate. If a certain threshold of valuation has been reached, then the drag right could be triggered as well.
Yeah. I mean, what you did not put in there, what's oftentimes also agreed on, is because a fund has a certain lifespan and a kind of a tail period, but then that's it, is that the fund wants to have the right to appoint an investment banker to sell the company and has the approval of everyone. So it kind of enforced the drag along already in the shareholders agreement. So that's not in there, and typically we don't see that in an early stage. But in a later stage investment or a fund that is already is investing at the end of its investment period, we see these kind of provisions.
What I'm really missing here is and we need to discuss it in order to bring it to put it into the term sheet, is a let's say share sell let's say restriction for a really period of time, or
a lockup period.
This is missing in this term sheet. Sorry, my fault. We need this lockup.
Too late.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. I think it was a junior associate who has done it.
Yeah, it must have.
So anyway, just to wrap it up, because we're running out of time. Yeah. I think one interesting provision might be the reps and warranties to discuss about, and then coming up to the fees and expenses, which is really fun.
Yeah, one point before that, real quick. We have what do you see? The resignation of a founder call option. That is a rare provision, I would say, but it typically protects everyone else. If a founder leaves the company after all his shares have been vested, and he can keep all his shares, he's just a shareholder, no longer in the management. He's a good leaver and everything, but you don't want to drag him on all the way to the exit. Then some investors, and here in this case, we would obviously argue against it. But you see this sometimes, that the investor then wants to buy out that founder and say, on the basis of the last financing round, we will buy you out. And that's a very strict and sometimes painful negotiation. He has a good lever, bad lever, whatever. The next thing he does, he starts a new company and he starts calling up staff from his old company and tries to hire them away.
If you do that, get the guys to come to you. So like, there are ways around it, but it's very
You've
hard.
You've done it.
Very hard. No, I'm just saying it's very hard.
You seem very experienced.
No, I'm just saying it happens.
I think the deal is over.
It's been over long ago. We just play that.
Yeah, I mean, reps and warranties, exactly. That's always a big discussion because an investor, you have, after the term sheet, you will have a set of three agreements. The first agreement is the investment agreement, and it says how much does the investor invest. And it also includes certain guarantees by the existing shareholders. So the existing shareholders are two groups in this context. One are those who are in the management, who run the company on a daily basis and who know the company's business inside out. And the others who are passive in the management, who are just investors. The investors will always say, we don't know the company. We don't know if there is something wrong in the business. How should we know? We don't want to give any guarantees. So that's why the way it's usually done and the way it's drafted here is that you separate between what's called title guarantees, so these guarantees relating to the ownership of the shares. Those are given by everyone. So everyone should know if he owns the shares or if he has pledged the shares or giving a third right any or third party any rights to the shares. So he has the guarantee he owns these shares. The second is the business guarantees. Those are, you know, there are no, we're not in breach of contract. We're, we haven't been, in a, we were not in a lawsuit, and so forth. And that's what is typically only given by the founders. And so I think that's a pretty standard setup. And those reps and warranties are typically then followed by what's called a remedy section, what happens if those reps and warranties are being breached. Title guarantees, pretty straightforward. You don't own the shares. You have given them to someone else. A damage happens to the company. The damage typically in a breach of a title guarantee only happens when the company gets sold and you can actually not deliver your shares to the buyer. Then everybody else is harmed because perhaps even the company cannot be sold at all. So typically you are liable in cash for a breach of title guarantee. But you know, even as a lawyer, we can say, well, you should know if you can deliver these shares or you cannot. So I think I would be comfortable as a lawyer to say for a title guarantee, I'm liable for payment in cash for the damage that is done to the other shareholders. Different, so with the business guarantees, especially because only the founders, typically founders management is liable, and they usually don't have the financial resources to pay any damages in cash. So those remedy sections provide for what's called a compensatory capital increase. So for instance, Olaf invests 1 million. We find out 6 months later that somebody sues us for 300,000 because he says we're in breach of his software license or a patent or whatever. And say we didn't know it or we should have known it or whatever. So the way it is done then is that Olaf says, well, I had a 4 million pre-money valuation. Had I known that there's a 300,000 claim, the pre-money valuation would only have been 3.7 million. So if I had invested on a pre-money valuation of 3.7 million, I would not have gotten whatever 4,000 shares. I would have gotten 5,000 shares. And the difference, these 1,000 shares, are being made is being made up by a capital increase, where Olaf gets for nominal value 1 euro per share. That difference in the shares. So actually, Christoph would dilute, as would everyone else. But nobody would have to actually pay cash to the investor for the damage. That's pretty much the market standard for these provisions.
It really depends on the financial situation, social and financial situation of the founders. If we are working with founder teams, and we know that they should have invested in their company because they are pretty rich, then there can be a cash part in this remedies as well, because everybody should have some skin in the game, especially if he or she is breaching something.
Yeah.
So, okay, and who pays the fees for all the lawyers, due diligence stuff, etc., PP?
So, coming to the fees now, fees and expenses. Are there any questions?
So,
I like that. First of all, this goes hand in hand with the exclusivity. next chapter. So you have, first of all, if we breach the exclusivity period.
Let's stay at first with the fees.
Okay, so basically it doesn't work because you want to have a full, like a carte blanche for any kind of fee during the cost of due diligence and the initial transaction. So so this cannot work because I don't know what kind of business, what kind of lawyer setup do you use? Do you hire your buddy? You pay him 1.5 grand an hour. You have crazy due diligence. We're very, very at the very beginning of our business, so I think we should cap it at, I don't know, 10 grand. I think that's where something we would feel comfortable with. We already provide you with a pretty good draft of a contractual, of a shareholders agreement that we can work these agreed issues on. And let's try to keep the cost low because it basically will just take money away from growing the business.
So yeah, the company is in a relatively early stage, so the due diligence is limited because it's not a long legacy of the company. We will provide first drafts of all the agreements, which will be the investment agreement, the shareholders agreement, and the articles of association. We have a relatively detailed term sheet, so negotiations on commercial terms should not take too long, so we believe 10,000 is reasonable. And at the end of the day, it will come out of your money anyway, because it's going to be paid by your investment money. So we all have the same interest that these costs are being kept at a minimum. And you talked a lot about disciplining ourselves, so I think that should apply to you and your counsel as well.
So first of all, I'm absolutely with you, all your arguments. It's spot on, perfect. We have to keep the costs down, and exactly that's why we don't want to have a cap, because statistics in all cases have shown that if you have a cap, there's no discipline at your side as a lawyer from the lawyer side as well, especially. We invest 1 million, and we don't want to pay lawyers or due diligence guys out of our money, which we invest in the company. Because, well, there is no money in the company. We invest, if our let's say, legal bills and due diligence bills will be sky high, we would pay for it. And that's why a cap is not necessary in order to keep the costs down. But what we have seen here, especially in the cap table,
yeah. Are you a real person now, or are you are you an actor now? Or
I'm death serious.
Okay.
Honestly.
You have to say that. So you're
you're Olaf now. I'm not pretending to be this insisting investor. That's really my experience. If you have a cap, it's counterproductive in order to keep the costs down. So at first I have to explain why a VC is not able to pay his own costs. As I've said, I've done 6 venture rounds as an entrepreneur, and I went nuts. I went crazy on the VCs when they came up and said, you have to pay my bill. I said, why should I pay your bill, your due diligence bill and the lawyers? And nobody was able or willing to explain it to me. After I became a VC, it was so obvious.
I wanted to make more money.
No, it's so obvious. Why? Because our business case doesn't work if we would pay for every financing round.
So you use your management fee, which is...
No, then you have a pretty shitty business case. For every financing round, we are not able to pay this. Other way around. If we raise money in our fund... we don't pay the bill as well. The fund is paying the bill. So it's really a process. Having said this, if you have a cap, First of all, other way around. For 10K, you won't get bulletproofed, waterproofed legal documents. Forget it. If somebody says 10K is the cap, you won't have bulletproofed and waterproof documents. You won't get, in addition to that, a pretty good legal due diligence, commercial due diligence, and technical due diligence.
He's so emotional.
Yeah, no, I'm not emotional. I'm serious. I haven't seen legal documents for 10K.
I've seen them.
Yeah. And you were in trouble with some, you know, you told us that you missed some clauses.
Yeah, but that was first time you playing
because
the
some
experience.
Of your lawyers said, I can do it for 5K or I can do it for 10K. No. This is not going to work.
How much do you expect? Just probably.
Okay, yeah. So this
Olaf, to be fair, now I'm playing, I'm serious. Yeah. Also, I would never give you. I would never give you a carte blanche for no cap at all.
Yeah.
Because I know what the thing costs. I would probably say max cost total 25K. But that's all in.
So
for that phase.
For 25.
Even then, I would not feel.
So we are getting there. For 25 from our side, in a very early Series A where we don't have.
Let's say this case. Let's play this.
Where we don't have to draft. The documents. If we do have to draft the documents, so our lawyers are writing the documents, it's much more complicated, much more work than just editing the documents, which comes from you guys. Then with 25, we can be fine because we have to do an external due diligence in for tech, financial, and commercial. Why? Because we don't invest only our money like a business angel. We invest, let's say, our investors' money. We have to do this, and that's why we have to spend money for it. 25, fine, it might work, but, and here are some examples. We do, the investor is doing due diligence, and all of a sudden is running into an IP problem. Nobody had, let's say, found it out before, and then, you know, our lawyers are trying to fix it, and this costs money. And if we have a cap, we can't do this. And that's why.
But those are possibilities. I mean, I'm with you on one point. I have never seen a deal with a cap where the legal bill was less than the cap.
Exactly.
So no matter
like
how much.
Budget.
Exactly.
It's like, you know, there. Anyway. So.
Yeah. Yeah, but for example, Lieferando, our latest investment round before we sold / merged. Legal cost was over 350K. Mm-hmm. That's just from the investor.
Don't pinpoint on me. I wasn't involved.
I mean, you
but
have,
just
you
to
have,
give you an example, if you have no cap, there are some people. Then you have lawyer. If they know there's no cap on it, we were on a tech call. There are four partners in the call. One associate was speaking because he was the only guy who knew how a domain would work. But the four partners built. So this is what's happening. So. I don't want to pay 350K.
No,
that's just the lawyers.
Not.
Then you got the due diligence.
I want to kick out the investor.
They used OCNC, which is like a consulting firm. That's another 500 grand. We had an investment bank invest in us. So
okay,
these things happen. So it's I would never, ever.
Okay, you made your point. Olaf made your point.
They
you should change the sides.
They picked up their fee. Yeah, but
their fee. But you know, at the end of the day, the legal costs. I mean, you have. Lawyers that are, you know, experienced in these kind of transactions and who are pragmatic, and you have lawyers that are neither of those or who are experienced but not pragmatic. And a non-pragmatic lawyer can be the biggest
pain in the ass.
Pain in the ass in a deal like this.
So okay,
and,
guys, sorry, we have to interrupt here. So
okay, deal done, Olaf.
What
thank
is
you
the number
much.
You usually expect from a series like this?
25K.
No. That's what you said, the maximum
25K.
Cap. What is it? How,
for 25K,
how
25K.
If you don't have to draft.
I wouldn't sign.
You wouldn't okay. sign.
Then
no.
we have we.
So
we have
a disagreement on the fees.
No, I will go back with the founder because you know we are working now on this deal for 2 months. We know each other. I will have a beer with him. Explain, Christoph. I hate lawyers. Lawyers are carpenters. Yeah. No, I don't hate
hey,
you.
Hey,
I don't
partner,
hate you.
Your partner
no.
is a lawyer.
Yeah, I know. No, but he's not practical.
For a presence.
Yeah, so what is a lawyer for you all? It's like a plumber. Yeah? Yeah. A lawyer is a specialist in this legal stuff.
Yeah, but
you need let me finish. You need the lawyer to, you know, to make your company bulletproof, waterproof from a legal perspective. It's very important. And if there's a founder with a Wald- und Wiesenanwalt, whatever that means in English, a non-experienced lawyer, I would say to Christoph, change your lawyer. I want to have a professional lawyer on the other side.
And that's fair. I still think, and here's the point. I would go out. It's reasonable because you don't have to do diligence on a business that is as early as us.
Okay,
I mean,
anyway.
You can do full on tech.
Sorry,
tech
guys. Sorry. We have to, step into
not
Q&A. Agree.
But, you know, no, sorry.
We agree one more sentence.
No. No,
you haven't discussed about all the protection things, but you're discussing about the fees that are strong. It means we're really emotional point for you.
No, it's not an emotional point. It's, you know, it's the most unimportant point of the entire term sheet.
But what tonight reflects is what's also in real life.
Yeah.
This is the longest discussion in the point. You know, it's like oftentimes, and you know, you can tell the character of your investor, you can tell the character of a managing director if he negotiates which company car he gets. Yeah. It's the biggest point in the deal negotiation. So, you know, I think
I had a red polo.
I should
with
be more
Fernando.
Emotional on this than you are.
But, you
it's not about the lawyer. It's about, and I do like lawyers, but lawyers are not operational involved in a company, and that's why you need them, but they are not so important. It's only important to have a good lawyer when you do these deals.
So
and that's why, yes, we do accept caps. Actually, I don't like them because I've seen it in real life that a cap is more a negative part than a positive part in this clause.
Okay, thank you.
So far,
get in the other investment.
Who of the guys deleted my buddy clause in there? Anyway, so questions to the audience. From the audience.
To the audience.
Yeah, maybe you have.
During a quick break, which is one of my favorites. So there's a lot of angels who are early stage VC funds that take additional equity for consulting.
Don't do that. Yeah. Never do that. I'm opposed against incubators, founders, accelerators. Sorry.
These guys.
I've hardly seen them living up to their promise. Like also, and that comes to the Thomas guy probably, to the advice guy. There's so much bullshit happening, and then people have 10 businesses where they're involved. They don't deliver. How do you want to quantify or qualify? Like. It's really, really hard. Get good people to give you money.
They don't have any skin in the game.
I mean,
that's the problem with these guys.
When a company is formed or at a very early stage, founders often are too generous to give equity away. And then at a later point, when they're diluted to a certain degree, they have this oh shit experience where they
say, I shouldn't have done it.
shouldn't have done that. And all of a sudden, they have a guy with like 10% in the company who made a couple of phone calls and a couple of intros. And all of a sudden, there's this huge disproportion that's been created. And in an exit, it will create distraction in financing rounds. Investors like Olaf will come in and say, this guy either needs to give away a certain portion of his shares or we wash him out. And we have that in, I would say, the majority of the cases where these business angels are invested with a disproportionately high equity share. It will come to you will have to come to Jesus with the guy and say, okay, this is not working out. And that come to Jesus obviously is a problem if you have no leverage on him and he has no reason to actually surrender.
It's really hard to quantify how much what's the value of an introduction. But if you see, I mean, there's one guy in Berlin, lot of investments. And he always goes in, yeah, if I come in, you give me 25% of your business, the company is worth X more and I can make an introduction here and there. If you build a good product, you get these introductions. You come to meetings like here, you go to Olaf, you say, hey, I've got an idea. You don't pitch him right here. You say, hey, I have an idea. Can I have your email address? Can we meet for coffee? If he likes it, he meets you for coffee. But that's the same thing. You meet, like, that's how you get the introductions. And as you said, a lot of investors are actually already that we know, or I know, probably you know the guys. They both definitely know who I mean. You tend to shy away from these deals, and it's.
I think you have to do your due diligence on the guy, and you might have to make sure that he's not out for a free lunch, and he has to commit to doing certain things, and has to commit to a vesting and everything else if you agree to something like that. And that applies to incubators, accelerators, what have you as well. And accelerators sometimes are good, and oftentimes you have you lack a certain position in a management team, or it's a single founder, which is also difficult from an investor's point of view. Investors would like to invest in a management team and not a single person. And then you're left to team up with incubators, for instance. But it will create a problem on the cap table down the road.
Thank you.
The specific question was investors who will get equity for work. I've seen this from a venture capitalist offering a normal equity investment, and in addition, XYZ percent for the work he's doing. I think it's bullshit. Because you know, we have an investment team of 8 investment professionals, and honestly, we work our fingers to the bone for our portfolio companies because we have invested in them, and we don't want to get additional percentage or shares from the company. Because we are helping them. That's the nature of our business, to support our investments.
Otherwise, you can't secure your investment or. Yeah. Control it. So, questions, please.
The question is about venture capital exit route. You mentioned almost in passing that in the regular parts, that exit. So, by nature, venture capital comes in with a way to the company has grown to get out. How does it come in here?
First, we do have the right to sell our shares, whether in a secondary transaction. Sometimes, you know, if a venture capitalist has a company in his portfolio, the company needs a little bit longer really to grow and to be, let's say, ready for an exit, whether an IPO or a trade sale. But the venture capitalist has to, let's say, to close the fund, then VCs are selling the shares to a secondary investor. It's a financial investor as well. It's more or less the same like the VC. And we do have the right to do this because we need an exit. It's our business model.
So, hi, Janko from Startupbootcamp. Two quick questions. One is, how do you evaluate businesses that are fundraising, let's say, in Series A, but are not generating revenues? They have amazing traction in terms of downloads, users, and fundraising of 1 to 3 million. Mm-hmm. Second is, how do you go about due diligence when a team is like based out of India and Europe, for instance, and their core IP sits somewhere in some remote place?
Mm-hmm. Okay, two different questions. First question, you know, in order how to bring up a valuation of a company pre-revenue, and what you have learned at business school, for example, discounted cash flow, forget it. Yeah, this is private equity stuff.
You have no cash flow to discount. So.
Exactly, or the other, let's say, measurements. It's market, it's demand and supply. You know, we do peer group analysis. So, what kind of valuation? On what kind of valuation have been other investments been done? Then we do, as a VC, we do exit analyses. That means we simulate the entire lifetime of a company. And at the very end, there are exit valuations based on revenue, blah, blah, blah. And so we pretend to foresee the lifetime of the entire company. And it's the founding team. You know, Christoph and his co-founders now with his new company are very experienced founders. They can, let's say, ask for much higher valuations than a first-time team, 25 years old. So because we know, well, they have done a lot of mistakes in their companies before, and they have, let's say, generated a lot of experience, which might be a more secure investment for us. So there are, let's say, a lot of parameters in order to find the right valuation. But the most important one is supply and demand. But, for example, there are venture capital firms with no people on the ground in Germany, big pockets, flying in to Berlin or to Munich or to Hamburg because there's an interesting company, and throwing on a totally incredible valuation money on the table. So the question is, as a founder, how smart is this money? Yeah? Can they really help me, or are they just buying a stake of my company on a very high valuation? So what we have seen is that VCs in Germany with a good team, with a good reputation, can invest on a little bit lower valuation if they bring much more onto the table than just money. This is the first question. Second question was... I won't say this is a showstopper for me, but we are a tech investor. We are investing in technology companies, software and stuff like this. And offshore development teams must be a brilliant case before I invest in this company, because I want to see the dev team, the CTO, the people who are working on the code. As I've said, you know, there are two kinds of people in a software company early stage, whether they produce code or they sell code. I don't like the setup.
So they have to transfer all their IT to a German company. That's attraction.
You never know, but you know, this was a general question and this was a general answer. There are outliers, absolutely.
But even the setup is shit. If you go there, look, we've got an IT in India, and then you come back half a year later, look, my IT is in Berlin now. It's kind of weird. Yeah. Start with IT in Germany.
Hey, my name is Kurs.
Where are you sitting?
Here. Sorry. Ah. I have a question regarding vesting or founder vesting. I totally understand the vesting period, which totally makes sense. My question would be regarding the cliff, because I'm adding, or at least trying to add value from day one. So why the cliff of 6 months or a year until I get kind of my?
Because first year doesn't matter. Second year doesn't matter. Like. If you sell your business, I mean, that might sound like an investor, but you make money with the company in year 6, 7, 8, 9. Year one, you won't have the same business as that you have now that you have in when you sell the business. So I kind of, there's so much shit happening down the road. I would say, okay, you can't put the cake in the oven. Or you can't make it, but if you're not there to eat it when it's finished, that's just how it is.
Yeah, I think it's a punishment, and a founder who leaves the company before it gets sold always does damage. And he can be a good founder; it can be the most understandable reason why he leaves. But there's always going to be a legacy. It's always a damage to the company. Unless it's so late stage that it all runs by itself, but you always have to explain, why did this guy leave? What happened? Is there a disruption in the management team? Does he have IP? Does he have a non-compete? Does he have a non-solicitation? Does he have any knowledge? You know, it's never easy.
So why not extend the vesting period from 3 to 6?
It will happen the moment you get another investor in. It will start again. What happens is you are in, I know, 24 months into your vesting, you have 75% or 70 something of your share secured. The new investor comes in, Olaf, with his 1.5 billion fund, says, okay, look, I'm going to give you 30 million, but all of your shares are subject to vesting except 10%. And then you basically, all the shares you used to own, you still own them, but they're back in the vesting period. Because the new investor says, hey, I want to be secured. What happens if you leave right now? Well, after I put my money in. And that's something, in our experience, which you can never, like, this is just not negotiable in most instances, what we experience. But Olaf is the bad guy here. You can.
No, you know, we have seen new vesting periods in follow-on rounds. We have seen no new vesting periods in follow-on rounds. It really depends on the company. It depends on the founders. But I want to add one thing to Jens' statement. Just imagine you are two founders, and all of a sudden, after 1 year, and you have 20 employees now because we have invested in you. Well, you have no motivation to work for this company. The biggest damage, in my opinion, is the damage of morale and spirit in the company, and that's why I don't want to use the word punish because it's very very hard. But that's why you need some golden handcuffs. I think it's prettier than punishment.
I think, do you understand, the vesting is ultimately, you're the beneficiary of it if you stay in the company.
Yeah.
Yeah, but still also the cliff. If you stay in the business, and what I've seen in other instances where people leave for good reason, where just they've been in the business, vesting wasn't through, but everyone agreed that it was okay for him to leave, even though they have a new vesting, and they say, okay, for this guy, they're all friends, and they kind of reworked it and made sure everybody was compensated in the right way, so it wasn't a bad way, just people change in 7 years. Most relationships don't last 7 years, so this is kind of natural. And most people, if you're in a good relationship, you can work that out to a point where everybody is happy. So I think it's, as you said, I've never seen it that it's being executed.
Where?
Can you raise your hand?
Okay. Ah, here we go.
A question more from an investment perspective. If founders have started, they already have another company on the side, and they start another startup, and they're raising a seed round. Is that seen as a distraction from
the... Yes, yes.
No.
Yeah. well, I think there's one famous guy, Cortez, maybe you remember, burned the ships. Do you know the story about Cortez? He was sent from the Portuguese or Spanish king to South America to, you know, conquer it with a couple of ships, and his team was not really motivated to stay there. So what he has done after they reached South America, he burned all the ships. So there was no way back. Full focus on this venture. And so if there's a...
If you're not Elon Musk, then...
So, but no, you know, if you have a couple of hobbies, it's fine. Family is fine as well. But one company or a normal job at BMW, Allianz, Siemens, you name it, or two startups, no, this is definitely a no-go. 100%, because there's not more than 100%.
Does the same go for a specific sort of... let's say IP or algorithm, do you want the startups to focus on a specific vertical or industry, or is it okay if we try all different kinds of things, throw it on the wall and see what sticks?
But that's very different.
Yeah.
I mean, this can't be compared to... this is kind of a business decision you make as a business together. Once Olaf would be, sorry to answer your question, but once you would be involved, a good VC sits down with you and say, hey, let's see what works. If you're in an early stage, you present them with options. Olaf would say, hey, look, this is very different. I would approach from this side. He would say, okay, this team I can work with. Let's invest in early stage. But this is nothing. That's what I mean. It's what you said. It's more about team. People invest in teams. It's not so much about...
Christoph and I, for example, we are involved somehow both in a company where...
Business-wise,
where... I've done a seed investment, 1.1 million, and 3 or 4 months after we've invested some years ago, the founders came and said, doesn't work, we have to do a pivot. So what, I can go nuts and crazy or say, okay, let's sit together and find something, and now it's a very successful company.
And Lieferando started in a different way than what it is right now. So it's kind of, nobody gave us money for the initial idea, but everybody gave us an idea for the previous idea. So just changes.
Hey, Joe, one question, like, with regards to what you're talking about this evening. Is there anything where you would say it's, when you talk about hardware startups, or startups that, you know, like, are like very heavy on tech in terms of, you know, specific AI algorithms, or startups, you know, like, that serve more, you know, big corporates, you know, I don't know, Siemens, whatever. Is there things where you say, well, there are very specific things which you could, like, easily point out where it differs from, let's say, you know, e-commerce startups or something?
In terms of
term sheets. I mean,
yeah, sure, absolutely.
Could you just, you know, like, elaborate briefly on that?
Well, not that much in terms of the normal terms, but in terms of the cap table and valuation and stuff like this. You know, in e-commerce, I haven't invested in e-commerce because I think it's not a venture case for a venture fund like us. Because, you know, in e-commerce, if before you reach 100 million in revenues, I think there's this rule of thumb: you have to put 25 million into the company. So that means, if you simulate the cap table for the founders, whether the founders get diluted more or less to death before the company is really, let's say, picking up, or you have totally different valuations. So in terms of valuation, a tech company is totally different to an e-commerce company. If we evaluate a tech company, we do a very deep evaluation and due diligence. And then, you know, we say, well, here's the money, and then we stick to the company. In consumer internet and e-commerce, the investors more often are investing in, let's say, 10 companies, and after half a year, they're pulling the plug of, let's say, 8 of the companies. Because you can't predict if this really works. In a B2B tech company, you can, to a certain extent, you can really, let's say, in the evaluation and due diligence phase as a venture capitalist, you can predict, does it work, will it work or not? And that's why the economics from a venture capital perspective, as well as from a founder perspective, are totally different in e-commerce, consumer internet, compared with B2B, SaaS, or tech companies. Does it make sense? Okay.
Please explain.
We have gone so far over the time that we were supposed to. I'm afraid I don't think I can take any more questions. But what we really
One last question.
Okay. Who?
No questions.
Let's have the lady. I've got one for you.
Yeah, ladies first. Okay, sure. And then junior associates.
And yes, I have a couple quick questions. First one is a follow-up on your question. Because as single founders, as the lawyer mentioned, sometimes the only opportunity or possibility for a single founder to continue is to work with incubator, salary. But then what percentage, you said 60%, that makes sense, right? What percentage would you accept that eventually you, that's your only option? 3-4%?
Depends on your the phase. If you come there with a PowerPoint, I would say, why don't you get a second founder?
Okay.
Like, so get a co-founder, because you don't, we were 3 guys at Lieferando, we're now 4 guys. You cannot keep up with the pressure, or I couldn't, if you're one person. There's too much shit going on. You got people complaining, you got investors calling, you got lawsuits coming up, you got...
depends on your behavior.
Depends on the business, but there's so much shit happening, then your girlfriend gets crazy at you because you're never at home, and like, there's so much shit happening that you can't carry the load yourself.
That's sometimes it's difficult to find your co-founder.
Then take some time, but you can't.
So
like,
a VC can help with this as well. Here's a case. It was 2009. A founder, which I've known before, came to me, said, "This is my idea. This is my little piece of technology," and so I said, "Wow, that's brilliant. That's really cool." By the way, now is the CEO of Relayer, Joseph. Maybe you have Relayer's Berlin-based company.
So just got another investment from Climate.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. So he came to me with his first company, Julex. And he said, Joseph, you're alone. You need a CEO, because he wasn't ready then. And you need a CTO. And we have to relocate the company to the United States. So all of this stuff we have done as a VC. So we found a co-founding CTO, and later on a CEO. And 3 years later, we sold it for $110 million to Cisco. So you don't have to go necessarily not to an incubator. So if you have something interesting, go to a VC you like or somebody you recommended to you, and talk to them. And sometimes there are entrepreneurs and residents waiting to become a co-founder. Yeah.
Second question is to Lloyd.
One question.
Okay,
one last question. Let's do one last question, because okay, I've got to pee.
That was probably back to the design.
Okay,
so...
Sorry.
Because I think the US is probably 7 to 10 years. What about you?
It really depends. If you take the average of all deals, the number says nothing.
And your preferred exit methods?
Well, you know, the stock market here, there is no IPO window. We have seen one or two IPOs a year, I won't bet on IPOs. Trade sales are the majority of all exits.
Imran, is it urgent?
No.
Okay. So, because we're so way over, and I think we're supposed to be leaving the premises pretty soon, I'm not sure if they're allowed to tell.
No, we have time.
We have time? Cool. So here's what I want to do, because these guys have obviously agreed on the term sheet. Congratulate them. Well, we'll just pretend like you did, because this is a little thank you from our side.
With the investor afterwards, he was much nicer.
Yeah, there you go. But a little
Christoph didn't agree on the term sheet. I take his bottle as well.
Oh.